I am Meltem Seyhan. I am from Istanbul Tech Hub, and I am working as engineering director in Quick Commerce. It has been 1 year in Delivery Hero. Okay, why I wanted to talk about integrations today, because I believe that it is a common topic for all of us here. And also that it is not possible to develop any software without any integration. Even the simplest standalone application will have some sort of database or storage, so which is a kind of integration. As someone who has been working in IT for a quarter of a century, I think the most of the runtime problems are caused by the integrations that is implemented just considering HappyPath and not the failures. Since I like to look at the things from a general conceptual perspective, I will start with some philosophy, then talk about integrations in general, and lastly, focus more on one of the common solutions, which is circuit breaker. The reason I have chosen circuit breaker is that it is the youngest of all solutions. As far as I know, Martin Fowler has introduced this concept in 2014. And also, I find it funny and interesting the fact that it is inspired from the electricity. So this is why I will be talking about circuit breaker. Okay. I will start with system theory, the philosophy part of the of my speech. I am a fan of system theory because it can be applied to all of the different fields, arts, biology, ecology, chemistry, mathematics, psychology, engineering. So, and actually everything in different scope can be a system. For example, solar system, Earth itself, our family, nervous system, digestion system, or as human being, ourselves are also biopsychosocial systems. So according to system theory, a system is a collection of interrelated components that work together towards a collective goal. When we look at this statement, we can realize that every system has an objective, components and integration between these components. So if we see there's a problem with a system, which might be that it is not working totally, or it is working but incompletely, or it is working incorrectly. These are three types of problems that a system might have. Then the reason of these problems might be related to one of these three elements, either with the objective of the system, or one or more components of the system might have some problems, or there might be some integration problem between these components. So if we give some examples to these problems, for example, if you are a person that is that has extraordinary talents in the arts, but you are trying to pursue a career in engineering, even though you have some hard time in math, then here we, as a human being, as a system, you have a problem related to objective. Or as a sample problem with components, let's say you cannot move your arm after some sort of brain damage, then you have a problem with one of your biological components, your brain. And if you give an example related to integration problems, let's say a perfectly fine woman and a perfectly fine man, it is not necessarily, they don't necessarily have to have a perfect relationship. So there might be an integration problem and they can have the worst relationship at all. So also, there are some classifications when we look at the systems. There are simple systems versus complex systems, or from a different perspective, there are deterministic systems and probabilistic systems. A system is simple if it has a maximum of 7 components, and it is non-hierarchical and easy to understand. A system is deterministic if all the outputs can be predicted by examining its input. So you get same result with the same inputs always, then it is deterministic. If you look at the examples, for example, pencil is a simple and deterministic system, whereas cell phone is a complex and deterministic system. Weather forecast, for example, a probabilistic and complex system. Two kids playing in the park, it's a simple system because it has only two components, but it is probabilistic because you don't know what will be next with these two kids. So if you look at the software systems, they are almost all of them are complex and probabilistic. So what kind of integration issues we might have in software systems? First of all, I want to start with the definition of integration in this context actually. A remote call from a software component to another software component running on a different machine. If we take this definition as the, if you take this definition, actually, we might have some potential problem with this integration. We might have an error as the output of the integration, or we can the component A can get an unexpected response, or late response, or a late error. And actually, all of this should be handled differently. And for example, having an error right away is very different having than having an error after a while. So the common problems and solutions will be the same regardless of the protocol, type of the systems. It might be a database, a queue system, an HTTP protocol, or a socket, RESTful or SOAP API. No matter what is the protocol and the type of the system, usually the problems and the solutions are very similar. So, okay, before proceeding, I want to say that if you look at the system A and system B sample, it is always the responsibility of component A to protect itself against all of these situations that might occur on component B or in the integration with component B. Okay, what are the common solutions that we can apply in software systems? First of all, these solutions are not alternative to each other. You can use a combination of those whenever it is applicable. So first thing to do is avoid integration. When you are adding an additional dependency into your system, actually you need to think twice if you really need this, because an integration means that an increase in the complexity. So I want to give an example. For example, we were for taking calculating the price, we had an integration with dynamic pricing system DPS, but somehow it was not working, and the fallback is working, and we were having a different price. So we realized that there is a timeout before going to DPS because we were calling time estimation system and then getting the estimated time and sending it as an input to the DPS system. But we realized that actually we don't have any definition of price depending on the time. All of the price definitions was based on the distance. So actually it was totally unnecessary to call time estimation service before going to DPS. What we have done is we just dropped the time estimation service call and the problem actually resolved. Timeout is the second solution. It seems very common and actually simple, but I think it is complex than it seems, because first, there are different types of timeout parameters most of the time. And you need to know exactly how each of them works. For example, with JDBC, there's connection timeout, there's inactivity timeout, read timeout, etc. So you have to know how to use all of these different parameters. Second reason is providing and having a timeout parameter does not solve the problem itself. You need to find the right value for the parameter. It should not be too short or too long. So actually, this is the challenge with the timeouts, I think. Third solution is retry. In some cases, it might be a very practical and fast solution to provide to the end user. And also, you can use it as a temporary solution and work on the root cause in parallel. But you should be careful about the retry count and the time interval between each trial. You can use exponential backoff mechanism, which means increasing the waiting time between retries after each trial to avoid creating a storm and making it worse for the component B. Next one is fallback. Whenever possible, you should use a fallback. Most of the time, you can continue with some default behavior, even if you cannot get the response from the remote call. For example, if you have an integration with Fun with Flex in Delivery Hero to decide how to proceed in your program flow, even if you cannot get the response, the answer from Fun with Flex, you can still use a reasonable default value and continue. Here, logging is important because you may need to answer questions from your user, such as yesterday I was getting this price for my order, but today for the same, I am getting a different price. What is the problem or what is the reason? To answer this kind of questions, you should be able to see that a fallback is used for this specific order, right? So the logging is important here. And the next one is also logging and tracing. Logging in general important in software development for problem solving, but especially if we are talking about integrations, you should know whether or not you are able to send the request to the other party and your inputs, what were the inputs and what was the response and what was the duration. But when you are using logging, be careful about the following. You must be familiar with the logs produced by your application. Check them often to see if a log is usual, normal, or it can be attributed to the problem. And also you should be able to configure log levels, enable, disable them during the runtime. And you should not write anything unnecessary to avoid too much noise and also to avoid storage consumption and be mindful about cost. And the next one is circuit breakers. Actually, we will talk more on circuit breakers. Okay. In electricity, circuit breaker is something totally different. A circuit breaker is an electrical safety device designed to protect an electrical circuit from damage caused by an overcurrent or short circuit. Its basic function is to interrupt current flow, to protect equipment, and to prevent the risk of fire. If we go back to system theory, there is this concept of adaptive system, which is a system with the ability to monitor and regulate its own performance. And you can see that actually circuit breaker is a totally adaptive system, right? And we all have it in our homes. I guess it is also called fuse box. Okay, in software, actually, it is very similar. It's a very similar concept. It works in a very similar way, but a bit improved because it also has the ability to go back to its normal state. Its normal state automatically when everything is goes back to normal, right? But in the electricity version, you have to do it manually most of the time. Okay, the purpose of a circuit breaker is mainly to save your own component, let's say component A, from being affected by the problems of component B. For example, if you have a Java application with a thread pool of, let's say, 50 threads, and these threads are calling to a database, and database responding very slow, in a very slow way, then each thread will start to wait, and according to your throughput, if you have a high throughput, after a while, actually you will exhaust thread pool, and there will be no available threads to your customers, your users. So the purpose of circuit breaker is actually to save yourself in these cases. But it also helps component B by reducing the unnecessary stress load from it, so that B can go back to its stable state more easily with less load coming in. The circuit breaker is, I mean, for example, if you are using serverless, maybe using a circuit breaker is not necessary. It's not that meaningful, but in other cases, it's very useful. Okay, how it works? Actually, it has three states. It can be in closed state, which is the default state. In this state, all requests are forwarded to component B. The circuit breaker, at the same time, constantly checks the health of the integration. If it decides there is a problem with the component B, and this decision might be depending on some rules, for example, some conditions such as 5 consecutive errors or 8 errors within 10 minutes, then actually it can decide, okay, a threshold exceeded, there is a problem with component B, and it goes to open state. So during open state, actually requests are not forwarded to B. It just doesn't send any request to B. But after a timeout period, which can be also configurable, if the timeout is exceeded, then actually it changes its state to half open. And in this half open state, only some of the requests are sent to B to see if there is still a problem or it is already solved and everything is fine. So if it decides that the problem persists still, then it goes back to open state and waits another timeout interval. If it decides that everything is fine now and there is no more problem, then it goes back to its default state, which is the closed state. Okay, here we have an example library for Golang. It's called Sony GoBreaker. It has some basic settings. You can define interval to clear the counters or the timeout interval.
Okay, that's good.
Sorry, I couldn't hear.
Sorry, Metam, go ahead. I think there was some translation from Korean in there as well. Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead, sorry.
Okay. So, and actually this is an example application that is using GoBreaker. Here you have a very simple remote call function in Golang. And in the main method, instead of calling this remote call function directly, you are actually wrapping it with a circuit breaker execute function. So this execute function handles all the logic for you, but of course you should first, in the init method, you should first initialize the circuit breaker object with the necessary settings, and then you can use it with your integrations. It's very straightforward and it helps a lot. So to wrap it up, when you are dealing with integrations, you should be careful and think all the potential problems and address them with common solutions or best practices. Usually implementing the happy path of the integration is just 10% of the required effort. We should be aware of the remaining 90%, right? So, and we should remember that it's our responsibility to minimize the impact of an external system issue on our system. Okay, that was all.